Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise as you're seated tonight. As my ushers have come forward tonight. We have a lot of special prayer requests tonight. Let me go over them. Just the newer ones quickly. Michelle Purvis, which is Brad's sister, baby, Aries Watson, they found a cyst on the brain. So we need to remember Aries. Is that how we say it? Is that close enough? Rose is not on him. Rose would have been a whole lot easier for me. But this, they're going to run more tests to figure out really what it is. But let's remember this child in our prayers, okay? Aries Watson. Joey Giddens and his family needs prayer. Lonnie and Carolyn Towns, both very, very sick. I've got a report this afternoon. I'm not going to try to go into that, just to leave it with you that they are very sick and they need a touch from God. Brad's grandfather, Donald Burks, needs our prayer. A friend of mine, a close friend of mine, his fiance is Dave, yesterday went to the Albany Hospital with COVID. Lisa Moore, remember her. Rhonda's Uncle Faye and Aunt Faye and Uncle Martin. Hey, close enough. Stone are both in the magnificent health. Both, he's 90, she's 89, both with COVID. They need God to touch them.
Amen.
Charles Brown needs our prayer, and also his mother Esther Brown needs our prayer. Ken Williamson still need our prayer as well. He is having some other issues that, besides just the cancer that is plaguing him. Pray for all of these needs. Pray for these other needs. We want to pray for the families of our church. We want to pray that God continues to bless this church and we keep the COVID out there.
Amen.
And that we're able to come into here and worship. I want you to understand we have been truly blessed. Amen. It is truly a blessing that we've been able to come together. And I truly believe it's through several things. I do believe it's in the power of prayer. I do believe that. But I also believe it's because we have tried to do what was right. We have tried to keep most of the social distance. We tried to do all the spraying. We've tried, and I believe when we do our part, that God
Amen.
Takes over
Amen.
And does the rest. Amen? And let me just go ahead and preach a little bit right here for a minute. Whatever's going on in your life, if you'll do your part, God will do his part.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, tonight we just come to you. Lord, you know each and every one of these individual needs. You know the specific need that they have. And Lord, tonight we bring these needs to you and we bind together as a body of believers, trusting that you are going to touch them. Father, the thing that I know for a fact is this, that when we're at our lowest, you dispatch angels to be there with us. A child of God is never alone. There's always angels there all around us. So, Father, tonight we lift these needs up to you. Lord, if there's anyone on this list that we've called out tonight that first and foremost does not know you as their personal Savior, first and foremost, Father, save their soul. Let them ask for forgiveness. And I know that you will forgive them. Father, these others that's on our prayer list on the overhead tonight, we have not forgotten those needs. Lord, there's just so many that we can't call them all out. But God, you know every need. And Lord, tonight we stand in the gap in intercessory prayer for them. Father, I thank you tonight for this offering that is going to be given, the tithes and offerings. Lord, I thank you for the faithfulness of the people here. I thank you, Lord, for the faithfulness of the others that have helped support this church. And Lord, tonight we just simply say thank you for that. Father, you're so great to us. You're so merciful. And Lord, even tonight, we know and we need to remember who's in control, and that is you. You are in control. No matter how things seem, you're in control. And we need to remember tonight that the devil is a liar. He will try to destroy us. He will try to get us down and out. But God, you will pick us up if we'll just look to you. Tonight, Father, I pray that you will just anoint Pastor Brad and that he will come behind this pulpit tonight with the same energy and the same anointing that he stood behind it yesterday morning, Father. Let that anointing be upon him tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
But you have never failed. Father, we're so thankful today that you've never failed us yet, that your promise still remains the same as it did the day that you said, let there be life on earth. God, we thank you for the breath that's in our lungs. Father, we thank you for who you are today and who you have made us to be. Lord, as we bring this word of God, I pray that the anointing and the spirit of God begins to flood this church, that people realize how important it is, God, to truly begin to say, yes, God, I'll serve you. Yes, God, I'll go the way you want me to go tonight. Father, I ask that you touch each and every one that's in here, that they feel the presence of God that I feel in this place tonight, that the power of God will consume their body, and that the anointing will flow out, and Father, that you will remove me completely out of the equation, God, and they will hear the word that I have. Father, today I ask that you touch them. Father, remove anything that's fitting to hinder the Spirit of God out of this church right now, in the name of Jesus. Father, I feel your presence, and I feel your anointing, and I feel the move of God that's fitting to rush out across the land. And Father, today, right here and now, let everyone clear their mind. Let the spirit of expectation begin to overflow in them. Let our hearts be open to receive and their ears be open to hear tonight, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen and amen. We love you today, Lord. We praise you today for who you are. I'm not going to take up a lot of your time tonight, but I can go ahead and tell you we're going to go as long as the Lord wants us to go. So if you got to go to work in the morning, you'll still be refreshed. But we're finna have service, and we're finna have a Holy Ghost move. I truly believe it with all of my heart, or it's just me. Maybe it's just for me. But I'm going to tell you something. The Spirit of God is all over the pulpit. The Spirit of God has been all over the church. As a matter of fact, I wish that we could have just skipped Wednesday and come right on in to 7 o'clock service, because I couldn't wait to get behind the pulpit today, because I knew God had something for his people that they needed to hear. And when I talked to Pastor Danny, I said, you know, I need to preach this message again, because my real reality of it was the people in the church need to hear it, most definitely, but there are so many that's out there on Facebook that also need to hear it. And I'm not going to call a lot of attention to the camera, because I don't want to mess what God's going to do in here up, but I'm going to tell you there's people that needs to hear this word of God today. And it's around one simple question, and it'll make Stephen's job a lot easier, because sometimes he'll come and say, Pastor, what you preach, and what's the name of the title? I'll say, guess it, I don't know. But today I'm going to give him one. And it's simple. Are you a spectator, or are you a participator? Are you a spectator, or are you a participator? And this message is, and I don't have a lot of notes, I can go ahead and tell you, I said, Lord, it's on you. But I tell you what I think God wants us to understand. There's some things that we must be as children of God. There's something that we must do as a child of God, and it does not remain sitting in our seat and holding the chair down anymore. It does not remain. And when you talk about a participator, I want you to understand what the definition is. It is someone who's involved in something, church. It's not someone who sits on the sideline and does nothing. A participator is someone who is involved. So what does God require us to be? Because a spectator is a whole lot different. You see, a participator is someone who's involved and who's supposed to be involved in everything that's going on, while a spectator will simply sit there in their seats and do nothing. Just bear with me, because we're going somewhere. Nowhere do I read that the Word of God tells any child of God to sit around and be a spectator, but too many of the churches today have become spectators in the kingdom of God. It's time to get the spirit of spectators out and get the spirit of participators in. Amen. And today in this church, all around churches in the world, and I don't mean this ugly, we have got too complacent. We have got too quiet. It's time for the church to cry out. You realize the Bible said we need to cry out to God. We need to cry out to God. And today in this church, I need you to realize something. We need to begin to quit being spectators and begin to be participators. Because if you go to the football game, the first thing you're going to see is a team out there, and all of those members on that team is participators, right on down to the water boy. They are all of importance. But you would be upset. You would be mad if you spent all that money to go see the Georgia Bulldogs, who's going to let you down at the end of the year anyway. You would be mad if you went and spent all that money to see them, and then when you got there, there wasn't a team there. You just had to sit there. Because they decided to sit on the bench. And I think God is saying to some of us today, I'm tired of coming into the churches and people just sitting around doing nothing. I'm tired of seeing spectators. I need participators. I need people that's willing to say, yes, God, I'll do whatever you need me to do. I need people that's willing to say, yes, God. And I can tell you in McCray Church of God, we need people that's willing to say yes, just like the next church does. 1 Corinthians 12, if you got your Bibles, you can go ahead and turn there. Verse 12. The human body has many parts, but the many parts make up one whole body, so it is with the body of Christ. Now, Chris, just leave it right there for just a minute because we're going to go through these. The human body has many parts, which means that the human body has arms, the human body has legs, the human body has a voice, the human body has a mouth, and so on and so on and so on. But in this scripture, Paul is telling us and comparing the body of Christ to us because look at what he says. But the many parts make up one whole body, and so it is with the body of Christ. So what that tells me today, church, is us as a whole has to be all together to make up that one body. And if you're a member of this church, you're a body of Christ, and you're a member of this body, which means there's something that you're supposed to be doing in this body. And then in verse 13, and I never tell you to underline nothing in your Bible, but I'm fitting to. Some of us are Jews, and some of us are Gentiles. Some are slaves, and some are free. But we have all, now listen to this, all been baptized with one body. Amen. With one body. Which means we should all be in sync together. We shouldn't be working against each other. If your lungs worked against your body, you wouldn't be able to do a lot. And I'm here today to tell you, if you're supposed to be the lung of this body of Christ, you must work with the body or you will hold the body back. Woo! He says, with one spirit. I want you to underline these. One body, one spirit. Underline them too because you need to remember them. He says, one spirit. It does not mean that your spirit is different. The Holy Spirit for you is different than me. It all is the same spirit. It's not better for me. Oh, he gets more than I do, God. No, I get the same as you do. He says, I give it out equal. So many jealous people in the church today. He said, we share the same spirit, which means the spirit that I got is the same Holy Spirit that you got. It's the same Holy Spirit that Glenn's got, the same one that's Renee's got. So don't get jealous. You can all have a part of it. Amen. Come on. And in verse 14, it says, the body has many different parts, not just one part. So guess what that means? It ain't all about you. It ain't all about you. I'm sorry. You getting it the way God got it. I ain't got it wrote down. If you want the notes, I'll give them to you, but ain't none. If the foot says I'm not part of the body because I am not the hand, that does not make it any less of the body. In other words, what God is saying, I need a mic. What God is saying, if you don't hold a mic, that don't make you any less better, any of more importance or any less importance. It means don't be jealous. It does not mean that, it does not mean, church, that you have to hold a mic to have the anointing of the Holy Spirit. It does not mean that you have to preach to have the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Matter of fact, it simply means that you can be the toilet cleaner at the church and he'll give you the anointing to do it. But people nowadays want to get upset. Well, I don't get to do this. Who cares? You're doing it for God. If you're doing it for them, you're doing it for the wrong reasons. Amen. It's not about what you get to do. It's about what God's called you to do. Amen. It's not about who you are or what you are in the world. It's about what God's called you to be. If the ear says, I'm not a part of the body because I'm not an eye, would that make it any less part of the body? Come on now. Or if the whole body were an eye, would you hear? If everybody in here was a singer, who's going to preach the word of God? If everybody in here was a spectator, boy, we'd be in bad shape. We need participators, church. We don't need to be worried about what our title is. Do the title that God called you to be. If God's called you to sing, sing. If God's called you to white floors with joy. Whew. If the whole body were an eye, you wouldn't be able to hear. And if the whole body were an ear, you wouldn't be able to smell things. But our bodies have many parts, and God has put each part just where he wants them. Did you hear what I said, church? It says God has put each part of the body where he wants them. It doesn't matter what we want. He said, I put it where I want you. If I want you in front of the stage, then by God, you're going to be in front of the stage. If I want you greeting at the back door, then that's where I need you to be. It doesn't make you any less in my eyes. It makes you the same. We are all one body, and we should all work together. We say the United States could get united, but let's be real, half the churches in America ain't united. And I know this is hard preaching, but you just well, hold on, because we're going to get it. How can you say that the world needs to be united when God's people can't even get united? Do you hear me today, church? And I'm not down in McCray. Now, don't get me wrong. Most of the people here, you go ask them to do something, and they'll do it. They might fuss, but they'll do it. Says, in fact, in verse 22, or I'm sorry, in verse 21, the eye can never say to the hand, I don't need you. You know what that means to me? I can never walk up to one of you and say, I don't need you. I can never walk up to one of you and say, you're not important. God don't want you. God don't need you. Get out of the church. You can never walk up to one of these members in this church and say, God don't need you anymore. Get out of the church.
Amen. Come on. Exactly.
Today, we need to realize who we are in Christ. Today, we need to realize that we got to say yes, God, and not throw all these excuses around, because he knows the excuses is coming before he asks you. Just say yes and get it over with. Well, God, I would sing, but they won't give me a mic. Well, I would clean the sound booth, but they won't give me a rag. Well, go buy you a rag and a mic. I mean, that's all I know to tell you. We got to get over all this stuff. It's time to move forward, church, and I know this is a different kind of preaching, but I'm being real with you today. There's too many people sitting back being spectators, and what I mean by that is they're sitting back judging other people that are trying to participate, and we need to get rid of all of that junk and get all of that junk out of our mind and get on fire for God, and you won't be worried about what everybody else is doing. Because God says we're one body with one spirit, and it is the same spirit. Your anointing ain't no better than my anointing. But you must choose to use your anointing. You must choose to use it. And then it goes even further and it says, in fact, some parts of the body that seem weakest and least important are actually the most important. You know what? That tells me that God says some of you that think, well, God, I know you called me to do something. I know that you want me to do something, but I'm not an important person. I don't feel worthy. God's saying, yeah, and you're the one I need the most. Listen to me today, because some of you have already said in here, you've already said while I was preaching this sermon, God, I know you called me to do something, but I just don't see how I can do it. Don't worry about it, but God can. If God's called you to participate, and he's called each and every one of you to participate, he will give you a way to do it. He said, all of you together, in verse 27, are Christ's body, and each of you is a part of the body. He didn't say, Glenn, you're not part of the body. You're a mole. We got to cut you off. He didn't say that. He said, each one of you are a part of the body in some kind of way. I've called each one of you to be unified and be a part of this body in order for it to function the right way. The Word of God is trying to tell us something, church. It's trying to tell us that we make up one body, and everything that we do as a church as a whole, and I think the reason God gave this on a Wednesday night is because this is the core group of the church. This is what the church is. Matter of fact, you are the ones that's normally working. You are the ones that's normally here every Sunday, and I mean that ugly, but you are the core group of the church, and you must be unified together.
Amen.
You must begin to participate with each other. Think about it. If the body's lung begin to not function properly, if you're supposed to be the lung of this body and you need lungs for oxygen, praise God, you got to have your lungs, and I'm going to tell you I need some tonight. But you got to have lungs to be able to do things that you need to do. If not, you're going to get short of breath. And when you begin to get short of breath, you're going to have to sit down. And what that tells me is God said, if you're the lung, you need to be functioning at 100%, because if you're the lung, you got to keep the body moving. You got to get it where it can run and shout and holler and move and begin to and heal people and pray over people and speak the word of God over people. You got to begin to be working full function. You say, well, Pastor, you saying all of this, and I don't even know if I'm a finger. It don't matter if you're a finger. God said each one of you are important. If you're the finger, you need to bend right. When God says grip, you need to grip. Whew. Praise God. Today, we need to realize something, church. God's got mighty things. I truly believe it. I don't care what happened in Washington, D.C. today. I didn't care what happened in Washington, D.C. yesterday. We're going to have to live through it and face it. So just hold on, buckle, ride it out. It's time to quit worrying about it. Because in all reality, God, you know what? The devil did not wake up today and say, let there be light again. You know who done that? God. The day is not the devil's day. When Danny Horn told me that this morning, I thought, you know what, man? You got a point. Because we get so... In some of our minds, we get caught up, well, today's Trump's day. No, today is God's day. Trump is not your God. And we must have a day like it's God's day. We get lazy. We get complacent. We want to sit down. I'm telling you, it's time for the church to rise. It's time for us to say, yes, God, if you need me to clean that toilet, I'll go clean it, and it'll be spick and span, and I'll do it with pride, and I'll smile, and I'll be joyous. And God, if you need me to come up here and mop this stage, I'll mop this stage. If you need me to go back there and teach teens, you don't. For kids, I pray you don't ask me to do kids, but if you do, I'll go back there and do it somehow. I don't know if they'll make it, but we'll try. Telling you, church, it's time to say yes, God, and quit making excuses. There's too many spectators in the church nowadays. And I'm just going to be honest with you, and I wasn't even going to say this, but I'm going to tell you. If people get mad when you talk about tithes and offerings, but the older generation is going to leave one day, who's going to keep the church running? Come on now. I know that's something we don't hear, but then you just going to get it the way it comes. If you went to the doctor today, and he said, come on in. You're getting a good report, but I got one problem. Your kidneys is not working right. We'll see you Saturday or the next time you come. You're going to get upset. You're going to get fighting mad because why didn't he tell me what was wrong with my kidney? Then you're going to call your children and or your sisters, and they're going to down the doctor for it. And then they're going to tell you, well, get on Google and find you a second opinion, and surely you will. We'll take care of our body physically, church. We'll do everything in the world to take care of the physical body, but sometimes we don't take care of the spiritual body enough. How do I take care of the spiritual body, Pastor? By being a participant in the body of Christ, by being a participant in your spiritual life. If that doctor said it's not functioning but at about 50%, you're going to want him to fix it. You're going to find a doctor that will fix it. Well, if your spirit life ain't functioning, if your body ain't functioning like it's supposed to, you know what you need to be doing, saying, God, I know I'm not, my spirit is down, I'm way down, I feel like I'm being held back, and you know a kidney holds toxins and it releases them out of your body, and sometimes you need a cleansing. And church, I'm going to tell you, the church needs to be cleansed spiritually. And then if that doctor can't do nothing with that kidney, you know what he'll do? He'll say, it's okay. We'll put you on a transplant list. Some of them people have to wait 6 months. Some of them people have to wait 5 years to get a kidney. But praise God, if your spirit needs a transplant, God said, oh, all you got to do is ask. You hear me, church? You don't have to wait on no list. We hold ourselves back too much. We're scared to ask God. We're scared to talk to God. We ball up in a ball in a fetal position, and we'll whine, but we won't even speak to God about it. Well, God, why am I going through this? Why? Because he needs you to go through it to make you stronger. That's why. You want to know why you go through things? It's because God is building you and molding you and shaping you in a mighty way. You can't ever be called a baseball player if you never put on a glove. You can never be a basketball player if you never pick up a basketball. Do you hear me today, Chuck? You might say, well, I'm a basketball player and don't have a clue how to dribble a ball. You can say, well, I'm a baseball player and can't catch a ball to save your life. You can even take it further. You can say, I race cars, but ain't never been in a race car before. And I'm going to tell you something else. You can say I'm a child of God all you want to. You can holler and shout it and do whatever you want to do with it, but the only way to be a child of God is to begin to be a participant in studying this word. Amen. Do you hear me today? Now listen, once you give your life to Christ, it's in that moment that it is your job to begin to learn and grow spiritually. It's your job to begin to be a participant instead of a spectator. The world is supposed to be a spectator, not the church. Do you hear me today? We're supposed to be participants. We're supposed to be the ones that goes out to the world just as Georgia runs out of the stadium and it's all hyped up. When we leave here on Sundays and we hit those restaurants, we ought to be hyped up, ready to tell the world about God. We need to begin to be participants. But the world sees us as nothing but spectators. Listen to me, teenagers. I told Mr. Benny earlier, I said, if you want to leave them in, leave them in, because I'll get them too while I'm getting. It's time for some of you to quit being spectators. I love you. Listen, Pastor loves you. But it's time for some of you to step up. I don't mean to beat up on you. I'm just telling you. You can't live on mom and daddy's salvation anymore. It's up to you. If God calls us home tomorrow, it will be up to you whether you go with him or stay back. You can't spectate for mom and daddy's salvation anymore. You have to have your own participation in your own salvation. When you have breath in your body, no matter how old you are or how young you are supposed to be a participant in God's body. He says we are a body of Christ and we should all be one accord and we should all be working together. Now, if you got 2 feet in the church and one of them's trying to walk backwards and one of them's trying to walk forward, it's going to hurt the church. Amen.
Amen.
If God's called you to be the one leg, if he's called you to be the right leg and somebody else to be the left leg and both of you's going in 2 directions, ain't nobody going to get nowhere. He calls us to be participants. And it calls us to do it together. It calls us to love people that we necessarily don't want to love. He also says there are going to be people that you have to have relationships with that you don't want to have relationships with. But because you call yourself a child of God, you're going to humble yourself down and act like you love them like your best friend. It's time to quit being spectators. It's time to quit sitting back, holding back on God. It's time for the church to rise. And the only way we're going to rise is if we begin to be participants in the house of God and in the body of God and in the world. We got to tell the world, hey, I know a man that can fix it. I don't give a flip about Trump. I don't care about Biden. I don't care about the White House because I've got a man that's in control. And if you want to hear what, you want to hear some good news for a change, tell them about God.
Amen.
I'm going to tell you what I done the other day. I come over here to the church and I was sitting there. And I caught myself scrolling. And you know, I'm the type of person, I'm not going to tell you to do something I wouldn't do. And I got to thinking, I said, you know, we're fasting and we're wanting a breakthrough and we're wanting all of this done. And I said, Lord, I might be hindering the whole church with this junk. So you know what I done? I took Facebook and I deleted it and wiped it off my phone. I deleted Snapchat. You don't have to go do that. But I'm telling you what your pastor was dealing with. It was hindering me from God because that time I realized I had done sit there about 10 minutes scrolling on Facebook. I could have been listening to the Word of God or something or studying the Word of God. The heck with Facebook. All it is junk and negativity. We need some positive things in our life, church. And the only way to get positive is remove some of the negative out of your life. Amen? Amen. And the only way we're going to be a participant with God is if we really get on board. And we can tell him, yeah. I want you to think about something. In the book of Exodus, I believe it was around chapter 17, Moses said, Joshua, go on up there and fight the Amalekites. Amalekites, I don't know how to say that word, but anyway, it sounds good. He said, go on up there and fight them. He said, I'm going to sit here. Now listen to what he said. You would have thought, well, he's going to be a spectator. He said, I'm going to sit here. This is what he said. I'm just going to sit. Well, actually, he was standing, but then he decided he was going to sit down because he was tired. And he said, I'm going to stand and I'm going to hold this rod. He said, and while you're fighting, I'm going to continue to hold this rod up. Let me tell you what Moses was doing. He said, I might not be the hero in the war, but I'm going to stand up here and be the one that does what God's told me to do, church. Do you hear me? The spotlight might not be on me. I'm up here on the hillside. I ain't doing anything but simply holding a rod up. But I'm going to hold this rod because that body that I'm involved with down there in the bottom, that's the body of Christ, has got to win this victory for all of us today. And some of you's got to realize that you might not be a part of the war, but you've got to hold the rod up so the rest of us can fight. Amen. And then Moses said, well, I'm tired. He said, I'm just tired, but he never dropped that rod because every time that rod come down, the Amalekites began to beat the Israelites. Read it. It's in Exodus 17. He said, every time the rod comes down, they begin to lose. Moses got tired. And listen to what happened. He said, I'm tired. Come here, Doug. You're pretty ugly to be on camera, but come here. He said, I'm tired. Sit right there. He said, I'm tired, but will you just hold my hand? And then there was another man that had come to the other side, and the whole time Moses' arm probably felt like rubber. But let me tell you what God said. He said, I got one man that'll hold his hand up and another man that'll stand there and help him hold it. Sometimes you're going to have to be the helper, and sometimes you're going to have to be the one holding the rod. Amen. Amen. Appreciate it. You got to remember that you're called to be a participant. It doesn't matter about the spotlight that you're in. It doesn't matter about the web camera. Leave that junk alone. We've been on camera since I've been coming to this church. Do you realize that camera's been back there for years? Now you can just see it. We're participants. And if we don't come in the right way with the right heart, we're going to hurt the world. We got to come in as children of God. We can't come in as spectators no more. Them days is over. God's calling for a revival. And there's a bunch of people in this church I've heard say, I want a revival. Well, it's got to start right here. It's got to start in us. Think about it. What if David would have said, no, God, I'm not going to fight Goliath? What if Noah would have said, no, God, I'm not going to build a boat? What if Moses would have said, no, God, I'm not going to lead the people? Or Joshua would have said, no, I'm not. That's stupid. I'm not marching around that place and then shouting. Come on now. In the real world's eyes, that's not going to do nothing, Pastor Danny. We're just going to walk around. Well, I sure don't want to do this. And then we're going to kick a few rocks and we're going to complain. That's what we do. Come on. Don't act like you don't do it. I've heard some of you. We're just going to kick rocks, but we're going to keep walking. And by the time we've walked around it, we've complained so much that the blessing of God's already gone. Amen. And we can't even shout the walls down. But if we'll just begin to walk. Just simply walk. Yes, Lord, I know you can do it. God, I know I ain't doing much. I'm just walking. Praise God, but I'm going to continue to walk. And sooner or later, boy, you'll be running. Let me tell you, you'll be running around the wall. You'll say, Lord, I can't wait to get to number 7 because I'm going to shout it down. Amen. Some of you need to realize it's time to shout. And it's not all about the shouting, don't get me wrong, but it's about the participation. It's about the children of God. If God says walk around, you just need to walk. If God says run, run. If God says jump, jump. If he says go mop floors, go mop floors. But it has to be participation. We got to learn to say yes. We got to learn to tell God, yes, I'll do whatever you need me to do. It doesn't matter, God, what you call me to do. I'll do it because I know it's important. Not only for me. Listen to me, church. He said we are a body of Christ. And I may be wrong, But if I'm a part of this body of Christ, that means when I leave here and go next door, that that body of Christ that is in there is my children. And praise God, I have to do everything I can to keep them functioning so they will make it to heaven. And I might not be the perfect father, and I probably am far from it. But I have to show them that it's okay to praise God in the house. You can tell, it's kind of funny now as I pastor more. Even River knows when a certain, when YouTube comes on the living room TV and Daddy turns worship music on, it's time for everybody to clear out. Because I've even got a sermon or I'm finna get ready to get one. I'm finna get in touch with God. I'm finna sit there and pray. And he'll go out. And it's funny, but now this is how the devil works. When you really getting a message from God and the message starts coming, there comes River. Will you play football? Can I hold your phone? Can you crank the four-wheeler? That's how the devil works. He wants to distract you, but what you have to say is, I can't do it right now because I'm working for God. And some of you today is going to have to tell your spouses, I can't do that right now. I can't go to the lake on Sundays. I can't go out on Sundays and miss every Sunday. I got to be in the house of God because I'm a body of God. I'm part of that body. And it, without an arm, they might not make it Sunday. Amen. How great is it that God, even though the world can't transplant a hand and make it function properly, or at least I don't think they can yet, God says, if I gave you the hand to give and I've called you to give and you won't give, sooner or later I'm going to transplant somebody that will. Church, listen to me. He said, if I've called you to be an arm and lift folks up and you've sat around and you look like a dead arm, we don't want a dead arm. We'd be upset if our arm didn't do nothing but pop. It would bother us. We wouldn't want people looking at us. We'd be upset. Not that anybody with a dead arm can help it, but I'm just being real with you. But if we become a dead arm and God's called us to be the arm of the church and we're supposed to lift people up, he's going to finally keep on and keep on trying to get you to lift people up. He says, well, it's time to transplant. It's time to put somebody there to help them lift people up. Don't get transplanted. Don't get put on the transplant list. I'm not telling you he's going to take you out of church. Listen to what I'm telling you. He's simply going to say, well, you wouldn't accept the calling, so now you lose all of those blessings I have for you. Because we got to do what God's called us to do. Some of you in here, you feel unworthy. But God says you're just as worthy as the next. He said, I may call you to be the ear, the one that listens and loves people and just so simply sit there and listen to their problems. He said, I may call you to be the voice, the one that speaks love and teaches people. But whatever I call you to do, you're just as important as the next. If I call you to be the foot, I need you to operate properly. If I call you to be the leg, I need you to function properly. One of us, church, listen to me. One of us can hinder the Holy Spirit in the church. One of us. It only takes one. If I get up in the morning and my lung is not functioning properly, it's going to hinder what I got to do that day. And if you come in here defeated, and look, it's okay. Come on in because we're going to try to remove it. But if you know you're defeated, don't sit back there and let that defeat just consume you and that misery just consume you. Get out here and say, God, I come to church today because I'm supposed to be part of this body. And I know I can't function at 100% like I need to. It doesn't matter if I'm preaching and you need to come. Come on. Well, I'll motion for somebody to come up here and we'll keep preaching. But you come and don't you let nothing hinder you from being a participant. We got enough spectators, church. We need some participants in the house of God. I want to close with this. And I want you to stand all around this church. If you're not functioning and you're simply a spectator, God may put you in on a transplant list. It's not our job to say I'm too old. Because if you was too old to do a work for God, we'd be preaching your funeral. Or we'd already been put you in the ground. Come on now. I know people don't like this kind of preaching, but I'm telling you what God has laid on my heart. And you can come up here and get these notes, and they ain't but 3 pages. I normally come with 7 or 8. They might be a little more, but I think it's right at 3 or 4. We have to decide right here and now how far we want McCray Church of God to grow. We got to decide, are we happy where we're at as a body? Listen to me, church. I don't want to stop anything God's got for us. But in order to keep moving forward, it takes each and every one of you to keep this church moving. Whether it be in finances, whether it be teaching, whether it be simply listening or loving someone or simply calling someone at home. Maybe your job, maybe God has called you to simply call and speak to people. Whatever it is, you participate in it. Because if you're not doing what God's called you to do, then you're simply a spectator. Well, how do I get the strength to do all that? You begin to pray. You begin to seek God like you've never sought him before. You begin to humble yourself before him and say, God, I don't know how I can do this. I'm just a little shepherd boy. I don't know how I can fight the giants that you're calling me to fight. But you allowed David to defeat Goliath. He was a runt. He was just a little boy. Goliath even called him a ruddy-faced little child. Come on now. He thought he was nothing, but David had something different because he had been participating with God way before this battle ever took place. You can't wait till the battle comes to you to start praying and worshiping and seeking God. You can't wait till the battle comes to begin to hunt scripture. You got to have them scriptures embedded in your heart. And if you don't have them embedded in your heart, the devil will pull you away from God. You got to be able to look at the devil and say, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. He is my shepherd. He is my fortress. He is my refuge, church. He is El Shaddai. He's our provider. He's our healer. But we want to be his spectators. We need to be, in all reality, his participators. Tonight, this is what I'm going to ask you to do. I'm going to ask you to take a second and decide right here and now if I'm going to say yes, God, or if I'm going to say no. And I'm going to read you this verse of scripture in verse 28, Chris. It says, here are some of the parts of God has appointed for the church. First are the apostles. Second are the prophets. Third are the teachers. Then there's those who do miracles. Those who have the gift of healing. Those who can help others. Those who have the gift of leadership. Those who speak in unknown languages. Are we all apostles? Are we all prophets? Are we all teachers? Do we have all the power to do miracles? Do we have the gift of healing? Do we have the ability to speak in unknown languages? Do we all have the ability to interpret unknown languages? Of course not. But you know what we all do have the ability to do? We have the ability to do whatever God has called us to do. All we have, listen to me now, all we have to use me. Use me. That's all you got to say. But be ready. Be ready when God starts to use you. Because some of you ain't never fought no spiritual warfare, and I can tell you it's not fun. Be ready. Because when you say, God, use me, the devil's coming. But you know what you have to do? It doesn't matter if God says be like Moses and simply hold the rod. You have to be willing to hold the rod up. You have to be willing to do whatever God calls you to do. And if you'll do all of those things in the midst of that spiritual warfare, and you go say, God, why me? Don't worry about it. He's got a plan. He wants you to do something. Pastor Danny told me one time when I was going through all the ministry stuff, and I felt like we was on a train track and every few minutes a train would run us over. And he said, son, you must be doing what's right because you're sure having a fight. And I can tell you today, it's going to be a fight, but that's okay. Don't worry about what's going on outside of here. Worry about what's going on inside here. Amen. Because this is what's going to matter in the end. We're only here for a short time, church. This is not home. We can call it home all day, but this is not where we're supposed to be. We're supposed to be walking the streets of gold and dancing in heaven. Amen. So I simply want to ask you this.
Lord bless you.
Will you become a participant? You may say, well, Pastor, I'm already a participant. Good. Do you have jealousy in your heart? Do you have envy? Do you covet things? Because you got to get all of that out of the way. There's going to be people that do things you want to do. There's going to be things you want to do that God hasn't called you to do. I wanted to stay right back there where Chris and Stephen is, out of the way. And God said, no, boy, get your butt to the front. Come on now. But you know what I had to say? Yes, God. I don't know how you're going to do it. I don't know how you're going to take somebody like me and do it, but I'll do it. I can tell you I didn't do it quick, but I did say, yes, God. If you're saying, God, I want to be used tonight, I want you to come around these altars. And I want you to truly prove to him, God, I'm giving everything up so I can be used by you. And I'm going to be honest with you, if you really love God, there shouldn't be a person in the seat. Everybody should be around the altar and say, God, use me, because I need to be used by you. It doesn't.